Wait, hold the fuck on. We're not going any further than that. Welcome to A Clockwork Orange.
A Clockwork Orange is set more or less in a dystopian future where law and order have become essentially obsolete, allowing for gangs to run and walk around freely. This satirical dark comedy follows the delinquent and rather psychopathic protagonist Alex in his conquest of enacting violent and sexually violent crimes during the night with his band of droogs, which in this case is used to reference his fellow gang members. Alex is a man of higher economic status and is seen as a man who can utilize his own wits and charm to obtain what he needs in his everyday life. And although this is the case, it is revealed that Alex is still a man who is driven by impulse and his own cravings of violence. The actions in which Alex partakes in are atrocious and simply distressing. The major conflicts that we see within this film follow Alex's and the society's values and ideas on order, reformation, and individuality.
Stanley Kubrick was one of the greatest, if not the greatest, director of the 20th century. Some of his movies are hailed as some of the greatest of all time, such as 2001's A Space Odyssey or The Shining. But what is not often talked about, or is but isn't that known about, is how crazy he was. From the way he treated his actors, to the techniques he used to make his movies, to the content of his movies, it was all very off the wall and controversial and in your face. He would break actors down to being to the point of crying in order to convey the correct emotion for the scene. Or he would make actors do insane things, such as A Clockwork Orange, where oftentimes actors would be bruised for days and days after filming some of the more controversial scenes in that movie. All of this plays into the way in which A Clockwork Orange tried to show how truly horrendous rape culture was. But unfortunately, because of the nature of the movie and the fact that it is technically considered a dark comedy, is often taken more of as a joke, which propagated the culture he was directly trying to fight against.
The creation of A Clockwork Orange led to a film that was both disturbing and thought-provoking. But for some, the film crossed the line in Alex's and his gang's ultra-violent filled evenings. In fact, Stanley Kubrick himself pulled the movie in 1973 in response to allegations that this film was glorifying and popularizing criminal acts, which led to the influence of people to commit similar copycat crimes. It's important that we note, though, that Stanley responded to the banning of his movie with the words, "To try and fasten any responsibility on art as the cause of life seems to me to put the case the wrong way around." At the end of the day, the film's violent crimes are truly extreme and so outrageous that it also emphasizes the fact that these crimes are strictly nonsensical and horrific.
The core of our analysis here is this. Rape was absolutely a problem in the 1970s and still absolutely is a problem in the modern era. As I mentioned before, in terms of how the movie portrayed its rape and sexual violence, it was attempting to make it seem so ridiculous that you would never think to actually do it. But unfortunately, because of the nature, because of the very bright colors and some of the more pretty visuals, people were often distracted by that and more focused on the scenes where it was just Alex, not the direct culture he was trying to fight against. This movie, in its attempt to vilify something, accidentally glorified it to the point where Stanley Kubrick, as mentioned before, pulled the movie from theaters in the United Kingdom.
There was a window open with a stereo on, and I vidded right at once what to do.
The propagation of rape culture within A Clockwork Orange can be seen to be connected to the rape culture that is something that we continuously see in modern day society as it encourages appalling behavior. And an example of this is the few years back, a Yale fraternity was revealed to be encouraging hostile sexual environments by continuing in a rather misogynistic ritual where they went to female freshman dorms and chanted, "No means yes, and yes means anal." Or another example is that infamous photo of the freshman daughter drop-off, where there are various banners surrounding that one with other misogynistic and degrading phrases. We've even been able to see society profit off elements that attribute to rape culture. Take, for example, the Sports Illustrated swimsuit edition. It literally profits off the fact that men are essentially drooling over women that are posed to be overly sexualized.
The imagery is so insane and so in your face that clearly it's meant to satirize the culture and the objectification of women by literally using a sculpture of a woman's body as a coffee table. To apply theories to this movie, there are a lot of directions that you can go. For example, cyclical theory is very applicable here. The plot of the movie is essentially, as mentioned before, Alex, not a great guy, his friends, also not great guys. It kind of goes through this whole arc. And then the movie ends in a kind of I'll never change moment that I won't spoil because I love this movie and you should absolutely watch it. The kind of cycle of abuse and torment that Alex and the people surrounding him go through is very similar to the cycle that actual sexual violence and rape victims go through. You either are not believed or you're told, well, what were you wearing, or you should not have been out at that time, instead of actually truly assessing the real problem, which is one of the most horrible things, but also one of the most accurate things about this movie, is that it plainly depicts that throughout its plot.
When viewing the crimes that Alex commits in A Clockwork Orange, you can see that he doesn't really reflect any sort of fear for the consequences of his crimes. As it was previously noted, Alex was actually a man of higher economic status, and viewing his situation through a Marxist lens, I found it interesting enough that his economic status and power in society could actually attribute to the sheer amount of disregard that he has for others' well-being. He is a white male and an individual of the Western world. The environment that he has could have provided him in some way to feel that his ultra-violence can be legitimized through his actions to reach his own liberation, in a sense that he deserves it, and he should be able to commit these crimes.
This movie's great. Please watch it. Have a good nice day.